She got her PhD from Princeton, advised by Rose Sobchak in 2006, and then she got her Hubble panel in 2006, and stayed in AAS for 3 years, and then she went back to Princeton for another 3 or 4 years, and then she got an assistant professor in 11, Carnegie Mellon, and then associate professor in 2014. So she's talking about the Galaxy Halo mass in some device and the implication for Galaxy Halo mass. That's about it.
Hey, thanks everyone. I've been here a couple times and it's always nice to be back. So my talk today is going to be about how we can use weak gravitational lensing and other measurements of large scale structure to answer questions like, why do these galaxies look the way they do? Why do they emit as much light as they do? Why do they have this morphology, you know, the blue galaxies with a spiral morphology, red galaxies, this dispersion dominated blob, right? We know that the fact that the blue galaxy is blue is indicative of recent star formation, so we might call this this galaxy actively forming stars, versus the red galaxies are more passive, no recent star formation. It's very easy to look at them and try to concoct a story that's based just on talking about things like star formation rates as a function of time. But in a cosmological context, we know we can't think about stars alone, because the majority of the matter in the universe is dark. And we know that these galaxies are forming and evolving in the context of dark matter halos. So presumably, since there's a lot of dark matter associated with them, the story that we tell to explain why the galaxies look the way they do has to, in some way, account for the relationship between the matter that we see and the matter that we do not see. So if we want, we could sort of rephrase the questions about galaxy formation to incorporate dark matter. So we could say, you know, how much dark matter is associated with this kind of galaxy? What were the relevant processes in its formation and evolution that led it to look this way? And what's the relationship between the visible and dark matter components during those formation and evolution processes? So if we rephrase galaxy formation in terms of these questions, we can try to answer these questions and describe certain interesting properties of galaxies. So it's very, we see the galaxy luminosity, so we'd like to be able to explain that. We'd like to be able to explain its color or star formation history, its morphology, and its stellar mass, which we typically infer by taking the luminosity and multiplying by a mass to light ratio that depends on the color. Okay, so again, if we're doing this in a cosmological context, we want to relate this to something about dark matter. So the question is, what are the dark matter properties that are of interest? So the simplest thing simplest way to describe a dark matter halo is to say, what's its mass? Okay, so total mass of the dark matter halo is an obvious property. Then you can get into some more interesting questions, like how much does the mass assembly history of the dark matter halo matter? Right? If you have galaxies that live in dark matter halos with the same mass, but that mass has assembled in a very different way, this halo formed earlier than that halo, does that have a measurable impact on the observed properties of the galaxy? So for the purpose of this talk, I'm going to have sort of two parts. In the first part, I'm going to talk about observations that tell us something about the relationship between the stellar masses of galaxies and their colors, and how that relates to the total mass of the dark matter halos. And then in the second part of the talk, I'm going to talk about constraints on the importance of the mass assembly history of the dark matter halos as well. So of course, if we're trying to answer questions about how does the stuff on the right relate to the stuff on the left, the difficult thing is that we only see the stuff on the left. Right? So we need some way of measuring the dark contents of the universe and then relating them back to the light that we see. So the type of measurement that I use is gravitational lensing, the deflection of light by gravitational mass. So gravitational lensing is an excellent way to infer the presence of dark matter. So this is a schematic of strong lensing of light from a distant quasar by an intervening massive galaxy. So we're all the way over here, and the thing we want to observe happens to be directly behind something massive. And the light has actually taken two different paths and comes to us. We naively extrapolate those back and say, oh, I see a quasar here and a quasar here, but do they look awfully similar? In terms of what does this look like on the sky, this is another sort of classic picture of strong lensing by galaxy clusters. So in this case, this is a galaxy cluster that has these arcs here and around another bright galaxy here. So what we're seeing is deflection of light by all the mass in the cluster, including the dark matter. And that's the last I'm going to say about strong lensing, because that's not what I do. I just like to show it because it's a convenient, easy to see picture. So the measurement that I use is weak gravitational lensing. This is gravitational lensing in the limit that the deflection angles, the deflection angles by which the light is deflected is very small. We don't get multiple images here. Instead, what we have are images that get distorted. They get what we call sheared. This is a kind of tangential smearing effect in the image. So this is a very small effect, typically percent level distortions in the shape, much smaller than this exaggerated picture here. Its advantage over strong lensing is simply that we don't have to rely on a serendipitous projection of one object behind another. Weak lensing happens essentially everywhere. It's just a matter of it being a much smaller effect. So the weak lensing effect depends on the amount of projected mass in the lenses, the separation on the sky between the lenses and sources, and the separation along the line of sight between us, the lens, and the source. So in terms of what this effect looks like, if we had an idealized background of perfectly circular source objects, and we were to put a bunch of lenses in between us and those sources, we'd get something that has funny, smeary patterns. And as someone who's used to looking at weak lensing effects, I would say, well, there's a massive lens in front of here because there's a tangential smearing around this point. There's a lens here because there's smearing around this point. There's a lens here, and so on. We can kind of get used to picking up these tangential smearing patterns that tells us where the lenses are. The complication, of course, is that that real galaxies aren't round. If they were, my life would be a lot easier. But again, you know, so we see a picture like this, and of course, galaxies have some non-negligible intrinsic ellipticity and nearly random orientations, and the coherent distortions induced by lensing are superimposed on top of that pattern. So the way we measure lensing is statistical. We're measuring coherent galaxy shape distortions underneath these 30% level random ellipticities. So the random component of the ellipticity averages down if you average over enough objects, whereas a coherent lensing-induced distortion will not average down. And eventually, it will come to dominate, and we'll be able to measure it if we have a lot of galaxies. So in terms of the science you can do with weak lensing, it turns out, can help us with a lot of things. We can use it to measure the growth of structure as a function of time, which tells us about dark energy. We can use it to constrain gravity. And we can use it to make a connection between galaxies and dark matter. And I personally like to do all of these things, but for today, we're going to forget about three of them. And I'm just going to talk about this one. For the purpose of the questions I mentioned at the beginning of this talk about galaxy formation and evolution, our primary concern was our ability to make a connection between the optical properties of galaxies and the underlying dark matter halos. And gravitational lensing is one of the best tools for making that connection. So the way we do that in detail, for all of the projects I'll talk about here, we use a technique called galaxy-galaxy lensing. So the idea behind a galaxy-galaxy lensing measurement is we decide a priori. I have a sample of galaxies for which I would like to make a measurement of the mass profiles around them using lensing. So these should be in the foreground. They should normally be selected according to some criterion of interest, like if we want to learn about the stellar to halo mass connection, we bin the galaxies by stellar mass, you know, choose our property of interest. So we have a set of lens positions, and then we cross-correlate the positions of those lenses with the shapes of background galaxies. So we can ask the question for each one of our sources, you know, it's at this distance from the lens, I'll set up a coordinate system that has tangential radial, and I'll measure the tangential shape of that source with respect to the lens position. So if we average over all of the lenses and all of the sources, we're measuring the total average matter distribution around the lenses, and that includes all gravitational mass, so including the dark matter. Excuse me. So in practice, lensing is sensitive to projected quantities. So if we say sigma is the surface density, so a 3D density projected along the line of sight in the lens plane, we don't exactly measure the surface density. The mean matter density does not cause lensing. It's the mean surface over density that causes lensing. So lensing is sensitive to what we call delta sigma, which is the average density within some radius minus the value at that radius, so that a flat mass sheet cancels out this. So this is just to give you a sense of what the data that people like me look at looks like. So this is a measurement of the galaxy-galaxy lensing signal from about 70,000 luminous red galaxies. So these are bright red galaxies. They have a passive stellar population, that's why they're red. And we have about 30 million, 40 million source galaxies in the background. We measure the average shape distortions of those background galaxies with respect to the foreground positions. So what we get is something that is binned by separation on the sky from about 50 kiloparsec. So this is about 5 times the physical extent of the light profile of the galaxy, out to 50 megaparsec. So a factor of 1,000 in radius. On scales below about a megaparsec, what we're measuring is the dark matter halo that hosts these galaxies. Excuse me. On larger scales, we see the lensing profile doesn't go to zero. That's because, of course, of clustering. Right? If we have galaxies, we know that matter is clustered with those galaxies over very large scales, and we're seeing the galaxy matter correlation function. And so in SDSS, we're able to measure this out to 50 megaparsec. So the shape distortions that we're measuring are on average about a few percent, like 3 or 4% here. Down here, there are something times 10 to the minus 4. Very small, but tens of millions of things, you can measure it.
Question.
Yeah?
Modest.
Yes. That's a good question. So actually, the reason we didn't go further here is that we were seeing signs of some kind of coherent systematic shear signal, some observational systematic that was operating on very large scales. The way we saw that is that we were measuring shear profiles around random points, which should, of course, have no signal because there's no average mass associated with them. And we were picking up signs of systematics that were not negligible compared to this error bar on larger scales. We think this is associated with various issues having to do with the SDSS scan strategy. So that is the key limiting factor. For SDSS, we actually, in principle, could go out to a few hundred megaparsec. For the deeper surveys that, like CFHT lens and things like that, many of the deeper surveys are smaller area, and so they would be limited to 30 or so megaparsec just because of survey boundaries. Okay, so we have these mass profiles, and then the question is, how do we use these to answer the kinds of questions I was raising at the beginning of this talk? So there are some complexities here in how we interpret this measurement. In particular, imagine this is the blue curve is like a 1D density profile, so 1D density slice of the universe. The peaks are dark matter halos. You can see this dark matter halo has a subhalo that has a satellite galaxy in it. So if we only had central galaxies, if we had a galaxy here and here and here, then we would say we're measuring the average mass profile in dark matter halos. As soon as we have satellite galaxies in our sample, that screws up that interpretation a bit, because whenever you have a subhalo, so you're measuring its profile, but if you get to scales of a few hundred kiloparsec, you get a coherent contribution from the host halo that produces a sort of bump in the lensing signal. And you have to account for that in order to properly interpret the measurement. The other factor, of course, is that all dark matter halos are not the same. So even if you did have a pure sample of dark matter halos, you know, this and this and this clearly look like they have different mass and different concentration. And so interpreting the measurement in terms of an average mass when really you've stacked many different mass profiles is non-trivial. Okay, so there are a few ways that people do this. One is using a halo model, a halo occupation distribution. So this is a probabilistic model for how galaxies occupy dark matter halos that in principle includes terms both for central galaxies, so how do the central galaxy properties relate to the dark matter halo, and also how are the satellites distributed? You know, what's the mass distribution of the halos in which these galaxies are satellites, what fraction of them are satellites, and so on. So in principle, you could have more than 10 parameters if you wanted to have a fairly free model. Another option is to restrict to galaxies that we think are centrals and just restrict to kind of small scales comparable to a halo and just try to interpret the signal as if there are no satellites. So what I'm going to show you includes two works that take these two different approaches. One is we're going to try to make a sample of central galaxies and measure and interpret that. One is full halo modeling of the whole galaxy population in SDSS. So basically, I mean, the punchline is we actually are able to learn quite consistent things from these two very different approaches, but I'm going to start by talking about the second one. So, yes, that is correct. Yep. Well, I mean, depends what you mean by fully formed. I mean, there are some that, you know, that are blue, and if you do a stellar population synthesis analysis of their spectra, you would infer that they've had recent star formation. So, I mean, these are not all old dead galaxies. Okay, so the first paper I'm going to talk about was one in which we just asked the question, if you select central galaxies of a given stellar mass, and you consider the red and blue ones separately, do they occupy halos of the same mass at fixed stellar mass? So, this is a question that's been explored before. by a number of different groups, including me as a grad student. So we use more data than previous work, and we also have some improved ways of modeling some of the complexities I mentioned. So we're able to come to a more definitive answer than has been reached before using lensing. So our strategy here was to select locally brightest galaxies as a proxy for central galaxies. So what I mean is if you have a galaxy, you could imagine putting a cylinder around it on the sky and asking the question, are there other objects in the cylinder? If there are fainter objects in the cylinder, you might say, okay, this is a central galaxy. If there are brighter galaxies in the cylinder, you'll say the brighter one is the central galaxy. This is a satellite. That's correct only at zeroth order. It's definitely wrong in certain ways. We corrected for that in a way that I'll explain in a moment. Okay, but once we've selected our central galaxies, our locally brightest galaxies, we measure the lensing signal as a function of stellar mass and color. And we fit the lensing signal to estimate dark matter halo masses. So we could say, for this stellar mass bin, we measure the halo mass of the red galaxies and blue galaxies. Are they the same? Okay, but as I said, this locally brightest galaxy sample, these aren't really all central galaxies and halos. And there are a few problems. In particular, first of all, some of them are really going to be satellites. It's not always true that the brightest galaxy in your cylinder is going to be a central. It could be a satellite. So there is this impurity. There are some satellites. The second issue is we may be inducing a selection effect. We're causing some incompleteness in the central sample. We are going to reject some centrals this way. And if that incompleteness is a function of mass, then that has the potential to mess up our inference of the average halo mass of central galaxies. The final point, which has nothing to do with the locally brightest galaxy selection, but is generically an issue in weak lensing, is that, again, we're measuring a mass profile for galaxies that have a distribution of halo masses. If we just fit that for an average halo mass, how does that correspond to the average mass of that whole distribution? So there are a few different issues here. Our approach was to use mock galaxy catalogs to quantify and correct for these uncertainties. So in particular, there are semi-analytic galaxy catalogs in the Millennium simulation. So semi-analytic galaxy catalogs cannot in general match all distributions of galaxy properties. The nice thing about these semi-analytic catalogs is that there are a large number of them. There are actually like eight of them, eight different catalogs. So we did this whole process. You know, we selected the locally brightest galaxies and made lensing profiles, measured all these biases in all eight of the catalogs, and used the differences in the results to quantify our systematic uncertainty. So we apply corrections for all of these issues, and then we add a systematic error bar based on uncertainties in this whole process. Well, we can do jackknives to quantify the statistical error, but that won't tell us about, here the question is, you know, do we have a systematic error? So first of all, in terms of what the data actually look like, before we talk about the masses that are coming out. So each of these panels is a different bin in stellar mass. From this bin starts as stellar mass of, you know, 10 to the 10. And then we're going across, we're increasing in stellar mass to here. And then here are two threshold samples just to beat down the noise a bit and make the signals a little easier to see. excuse me. So the red and blue points are the lensing signals for the red and blue lens galaxy samples, and the best fitting models are shown as lines. And you can see that consistently in every single bin, the red galaxies at fixed stellar mass seem to live in higher mass halos. The lensing signals are higher up. What's a little bit more difficult to see here is, first of all, you know, how big is the difference in mass? And second, how statistically significant is it? Is it that difference? So this plot shows the average dark matter halo mass as a function of the stellar mass, where the points are the best fitting masses for red and blue. And the shaded regions show the statistical uncertainties, which you can see are really blowing up for the high mass blue galaxies, because there just are not very many of them. So, excuse me. So there are a few things of note here. First of all, if you see these dashed lines, the dashed lines are what I got before I applied any of the corrections for systematics, having to do with satellites and incompleteness and so on. So first of all, you can see that both curves sort of coherently shift down by about 20%. The systematics seem to do very similar things to red and blue galaxies. Excuse me. Second thing is that the, you know, except for a very low mass, where, you know, again, the errors are kind of big, the error envelopes for red and blue galaxies are quite well separated. So we can say that, you know, it's a few sigma difference for each point up here, for example. The red galaxies do live in more massive dark matter halos than the blue galaxies. Okay, so the way we frame this is that the halo mass distribution at fixed stellar mass is likely bimodal. There are two peaks, one for the blue galaxies at lower mass, one for the red galaxies at higher mass. Final point I want to mention about, oh, sorry? No, so the systematic uncertainty is actually already folded into these envelopes. These corrections here are about 20%, and we think they're good to about plus or minus 5%.
So are the stellar masses reliable?
That's a really good question. So the stellar masses, like anyone's stellar masses, are not perfect. They have certain assumptions. You know, in their calculation, the majority of those assumptions would go the same way for both red and blue galaxies. There were a few systematics that were potentially different for red and blue, but those were most important, we found, for these two data points where the errors are so big that we're not really making any conclusions anyway.
Partly that must be because you separated your galaxies into two types. What's the cut for red versus blue? And is there anything that sort of is messy in the middle?
That's a good question. The cut for red versus blue is based on rest frame G minus R color. There are a number of popular cuts that people use to divide the samples. We found it didn't matter too much which of those we adopted. We saw, you know, broadly the same conclusions.
I'm supposed to be wondering at this point, waiting for the rest of your talk, about whether blue guys evolved into red guys or things like that. Red ones had to be blue at some time in the past.
Right, so the very next thing I'm going to get to is a question of what is the physical driver of quenching, which we can think of as quenching is a process that shuts off star formation, which will turn a galaxy population from predominantly blue to a predominantly red. And, well, you'll see this in a second, but we essentially try to figure out, you know, is it a galaxy property like stellar mass that drives that, or a halo property like halo mass that drives that? No, and that's mainly because it's SDSS, and the resolution is just not that fantastic. Yeah, but I think you'd be better off exploring this in a data set like Cosmos, which is, you know, very narrow but very deep. They do galaxy-galaxy lensing. studies that have pretty good signal to noise, and there they'd be able to do a really nice cut based on morphology. I think for us it would be a bit fuzzy.
There's obviously shifts in the curve to the left, you know, on potential for more overlap, so maybe not at the extremes of mass.
Yeah, it is a very good question. We just felt that it was this was not the optimal data set for studying it. Yeah. The final point I wanted to emphasize about these error envelopes. So you should think of these error envelopes as error bars on the mean. So we think that there's significant intrinsic scatter in halo mass at fixed stellar mass. So we're not saying like the intrinsic scatter is this small, and so there's a bump in, you know, the mass distribution up here and a bump down there. The intrinsic scatter is larger than these envelopes, we believe. And so the mass distributions may overlap. It's that their means are well separated. Okay, so in terms of how this compares with previous work, I wanted to highlight two particular things here. So one is, the shaded regions are my work again. So the shaded regions are the same thing as you just saw. There are these pink dashed and blue dashed curves that are quite similar, except they're a bit below my results. So those come from galaxy clustering. So galaxy clustering can be related to the mass distribution if you have a halo occupation distribution that basically says how galaxies populate halos statistically. And so basically this is saying that the clustering analysis that they did seems to roughly agree with our lensing analysis. It's more model dependent, but you know, that's a pretty nice agreement. Another example of a model dependent result that we can compare with comes from kinematics. So the red and the blue points come from the kinematics of satellite galaxies around centrals as a function of stellar mass. So this is work by Serhud Moore. And what's important to bear in mind is that below where I'm indicating, for lower masses, what they were doing on average was stacking something like one satellite galaxy per central and making a stacked distribution of the satellite velocity distributions. And so there's a fair amount of model dependence in interpreting that in terms of an average halo mass. So in the higher mass regime, where they actually have multiple satellites per central, we agree. In the more model-dependent regime, we have some disagreement. Their masses are always above ours, although they do agree that there's a red-blue difference. So Serhud and I worked together. We agreed that this difference in our result was likely this model dependence of the kinematics interpretation. Okay, so our conclusion is there's a bimodality in halo mass at fixed stellar mass at low redshift. That's the only place we can measure it in SDSS. And the host halos for the red galaxies are about twice as massive as the host halos for the blue galaxies. So that's an observational result. And I promised to say something about galaxy evolution theory, so we'll do that next. Okay, so it's really natural to want to compare with hydrodynamic simulations, cosmological hydrodynamic simulations that, you know, they have some subgrid physics that defines some of the small scale galaxy formation and evolution properties. They form galaxies in a 100 megaparsec box and they watch them evolve. That comparison turned out to be trickier than I thought it would be, just because of differences in stellar mass definitions. So I don't have that just yet. However, I was able to compare with one of the semi-analytic models that I was already using for that work. So again, the error envelopes are my observational results. The red and blue points are one of these semi-analytic galaxy catalogs based on the Millennium simulation. And excuse me, you can see the red and blue points are well separated, meaning they have a red versus blue bimodality. But it's not as strong as what I'm seeing observationally. So basically, the red galaxies seem about right. The blue galaxies are a bit more massive compared to the observations. So the bimodality is not quite as strong. The dashed curves, the dashed blue and pink curves, are from a model called age matching, which I'll describe in a moment. But for now, the main point is to see they actually have a bimodality of opposite sign. The dashed blue curve is above the dashed pink curve, meaning blue galaxies live in more massive halos at fixed stellar mass. So that seems to be thoroughly ruled out by these lensing observations. Something about that model just doesn't work. So the question is, what can we learn? So to answer the question of what can we learn, we need to think about how these models were produced. The semi-analytic modeling involves populating halos in n-body simulations with galaxies based on a set of rules, which can have potentially of order 100 parameters. So they're typically tuned to match some set of observations. Maybe it's the luminosity function at redshift 1, or maybe it's galaxy clustering at redshift 0. And it can't, in general, match all observations. So the model I showed matches some observations, but it doesn't quite match mine perfectly. And my personal takeaway is, OK, their semi-analytic model is not bad, but it's not perfect. And it's really hard to derive conclusions about what does that mean if you have a model with many tunable knobs. So which is not to say we can't learn something about the semi-analytic model, but it would be challenging. It would involve, you know, turning knobs one by one and seeing what changes and what breaks and so on. The comparison with age matching, I think, is more informative. So the basic idea behind age matching is they first assume a galaxy with high stellar mass lives in a halo that is very massive. So if you start with an n-body, you know, based catalog of halos, you take the most massive halos and you put the highest stellar mass galaxies in them. So that gives you galaxies with stellar mass. How do you get color? So color comes from the age of the dark matter halo. That's why it's called age matching. So if you have a galaxy at fixed stellar and halo mass, and the halo it lives in is old, you assume the galaxy population is old. This is a red galaxy. If the halo is younger, then you assign it a blue galaxy. So those are basically two very simple assumptions. And I think what this is telling us is that those assumptions don't seem to work. You could imagine modifying them in some way. But in particular, it seems like this first thing, assuming galaxies with high stellar mass live in massive dark matter halos, is not quite right. You need to allow at that stage for some difference in galaxy types.
That's because of the bimodality issue.
Yeah.
It's because of that.
Yeah, exactly. And basically, so basically, because of that assumption, their curves are always very close together. The fact that the blue is above red has to do with the age matching part of it. But bottom line is, to get this bimodality, you need to bake in that bimodality at the very start. Okay, so now we get to the second part of this. We're going to talk about halo modeling a bit. So we can ask the question of, can we say what galaxy or dark matter property has the most influence in galaxy color? So this is a question of my postdoc, my former postdoc. He just went to Ohio State. Ying Zhu, he wanted to ask this question. So he basically said, let's say there's a process called quenching, which is going to transform galaxies from star forming to passive. And let's see if we can figure out which galaxy or halo properties are the driver of that quenching. Okay, so he tried to do this using halo modeling of galaxy-galaxy lensing, so the same kinds of measurements I just showed you, but for the whole SDSS galaxy sample, not just centrals, and galaxy clustering. So in a halo model, the basic idea is that for central galaxies, there's a relation between luminosity or stellar mass, in our case we use stellar mass, and halo mass. So there's like some kind of mean relation between these, and then there's also intrinsic scatter, which is going to define an envelope that galaxies can live in the stellar versus halo mass plane. So that's an assumption of halo models in general. What Ying introduced was the idea that the quenching, right, the turning off of star formation depends on where you are in that allowed envelope. So in particular, if you look at these plots, the shaded region covers the same area in each one. But you see in one, the color is changing this way, and in the other, the color is changing that way. So these are two different models he wanted to consider. The average stellar mass to halo mass relation is the same, but in this case, stellar mass drives the quenching. So if you sit at fixed halo mass, the low stellar mass galaxies are predominantly blue, and the high stellar mass galaxies are predominantly red. Whereas if you sit at fixed stellar mass, you have the same red and blue fraction for all halo masses. Okay, so he called this stellar mass quenching because the quenching changes in the stellar mass direction. The second model over here is completely the opposite. Call it halo mass quenching. Right, so in this case, the halo mass, this horizontal direction, is what determines whether or not galaxies are quenched or not. So, in principle, there are multiple different physical processes that could cause quenching as a function of halo mass. The point here is to try to be agnostic of what exactly is the physics, just see if we can figure out whether quenching is a process that depends on halo mass or a process that depends on stellar mass. There's still multiple physical models in each bin, but we're trying to sort of explore classes of models. So if you look at these plots, and the important thing to remember is when we select samples, of course, we don't see halo mass. We only see stellar mass. So you should think of the way we select galaxies as drawing horizontal lines across this plot, like a stellar mass bin from here to here, or everything from here on up, or whatever. Selecting galaxies involves drawing horizontal lines. And a really informative horizontal line, it turns out, is something like this one. It's not immediately obvious why, but the key thing to notice here is that in the model over here, everything above this stellar mass is already pretty much fully quenched. Like the quenching rate is, 90%. So above here, 90% of the galaxies are red. 10% are blue, and whether they're red or blue does not depend on the halo mass at all, right? Because halo mass doesn't determine anything in this model. In this model, it's also true that about 90% of the galaxies above that line are red and 10% are blue, but here you can see that preferentially, the bluer ones are more likely to be over here at low mass. So for very high stellar mass galaxies, the lensing should look very different for these two models. The blue galaxies and red galaxies should have about the same mass here. They should have quite different masses here. And sorry, I'm just going to jump to this slide, which shows you the lensing by the very high stellar mass blue galaxies. So these are the ones that should look very different in those two models. Again, if we're in this model, they should be as massive as the red galaxies. In this model, they should be less massive. So if you have a model that fits all of the lower mass data, and you see what it predicts at high mass, you can compare it with the lensing data. So these two panels both show the lensing data, which is the same in both panels. The curves show the best fitting model for those two scenarios, stellar mass quenching and halo mass quenching, where, as I was saying, the stellar mass quenching model predicts a higher mass for the blue galaxies, and it's clearly above the data points. So here, the chi-squared per degree of freedom is close to 4. Over here, the halo mass quenching gives a chi-squared per degree of freedom of 1. So this model on the right, halo mass quenching, seems to be strongly preferred by this data. There are some differences in other mass bins. In every bin where there's a difference, the halo quenching model is preferred. This is the one where it's sort of the most visually apparent. So just to give you a sense of what this looks like, if you measure lensing on the bottom and clustering on the top for 6 different stellar mass bins, for red galaxies on the left, blue on the right. So you're seeing a lot of different curves here. The thing I want to emphasize is you can see that for a few mass bins, you see that there are 2 models, right? And they look different, like blue galaxy lensing. The 2 different models, the dashed and solid curves, look different. In many other mass bins, you can't even see that there are 2 curves going through the data points because they overlap very well. So basically, both models describe a lot of the data. In a few bins, we see a preference for this halo quenching model. So basically, we find that this model can describe the galaxy clustering and the lensing signals of red and blue galaxies over a wide mass range with just halo quenching. We don't need the process that turns blue galaxies into red galaxies to depend on something more sophisticated than that, like the halo formation time. The halo mass is sufficient. There's a characteristic halo mass associated with that quenching. It's around 10 to the 12 solar masses. And so this is something we could use to say something about what actually is that physical mechanism that's driving the quenching. Potential candidates that could be associated with this mass range include shock heating in massive dark matter halos, or feedback from supermassive black holes that are, you know, large enough to heat up the gas and shut off star formation. Excuse me. With these observations alone, it would be difficult to distinguish between these two. Okay, and if we try to use models that don't have significant halo quenching, we can't explain these observations very well. The halo quenching is really needed to explain lensing of galaxies at high masses. So this was SDSS, and the natural question is to say, you know, SDSS has been around a long time. What's coming next? So I just wanted to give you a little advertisement for the Hyper Supreme CAM survey, HSC. It always sounds like I'm saying HST, Hubble Space Telescope, but I'm not. So let me tell you what HSC is and why you should care. HSC stands for Hyper Supreme CAM. It's an instrument which was put on the Subaru telescope. It's this giant monster camera. And the thing about Hyper Supreme CAM is if you consider previous instruments which were on the Subaru telescope, like Supreme CAM had a half degree field of view. This HSC has a 1.5 degree field of view. So if you want to do a survey that covers substantial area, obviously increasing your field of view makes it much more powerful. If you have, you know, 10 times the area, then the survey is 10 times as fast for fixed area. Or if you have fixed time, you cover 10 times as much area. So HSC is a very nice instrument that lets us carry out a survey at the Subaru telescope covering 1,400 square degrees. So this survey is ongoing. This is a bit of eye candy. This is Andromeda. So there is an ongoing HST, Hubble Space Telescope, survey of Andromeda with something like 200 pointings to cover a fraction of Andromeda. This is Hyper Supreme CAM imaging just a single pointing at Andromeda, and you get nearly the whole thing except for the very edges of Andromeda in one pointing. We can also zoom in. It's an excellent quality camera, so we get, you know, lots of fine detail. So this image of Andromeda is on the NAOJ, National Astronomical Observatory of Japan website. It's really cool. You can zoom around and play with it. And this is also an image of just a really deep field to give you a sense for, if you have these really deep images, it's just, you know, there's galaxies and stuff everywhere. These are, we can, with relatively short exposures, still go very deep and have a nice imaging survey for weak lensing. So HSC is a nice place to do this, to do this science. It's a much deeper survey than SDSS, better imaging quality. So there are a few implications. The first thing is SDSS was limited to very low redshift, below redshift 0.3. So we can sort of think of it as a snapshot of what's happening, you know, right now. With HSC, we can use lenses up to redshift 1. So, you know, 7 billion years ago, some of these processes of interest were presumably still ongoing. We could learn something very interesting by going up to here with HSC. We can also push to lower stellar mass at fixed lens redshift. So in SDSS, you saw the errors were blowing up at low stellar mass. But since HSC is really deep, we'll be able to make substantial size samples of very low stellar mass galaxies and measure their stellar to halo mass relation, which could be very informative. So to give an example of what we could learn, this plot shows the ratio of stellar to halo mass divided by cosmological baryon fraction in SDSS. So the results I showed you before are these blue and red curves. They look different just because I've transformed to, you know, stellar to halo mass ratio. So we can see that's a low redshift result. The black curve is a result from that was done by Jean Coupon using redshifts 0.5 to 0.8 in the CFHT lens sample. And so that's averaged over galaxy types, this black region. So these curves look very different. And that's not a conflict between our results because, you know, it's a few billion years evolution between those times. So in principle, we could imagine that in a few billion years, this curve shifts up here, and it also shifts over. You see the peak is here at higher redshift, whereas the peak, you know, is more like here at low redshift. So using a survey like HSC, we could actually make the direct connection between what's happening at higher redshift and what's happening at lower redshift. So these were all the results I was going to show for stellar to halo mass relation and quenching. Since I'm running out of time, I'm not going to get fully into assembly bias. I want to show you just one result out of several that I was going to show for assembly bias, so something different. Okay. We're going to talk very briefly about the question of how does the evolutionary history of dark matter halos reflect in observed galaxy properties. So just to define terms, right, the galaxy clustering is, we look for the correlations between pairs of galaxies, and we can measure the galaxy bias. And our typical model says that galaxy bias depends only on halo mass. So using n-body simulations, people have found that dark matter halos, for dark matter halos, that's not true. Dark matter halo bias depends on the halo mass, but it also depends on the formation time. So at fixed mass, the galaxy bias depends on how early or late the halo formed. So that's a robust prediction of dark matter simulations that's extremely difficult to measure experimentally because we have no way of grouping halos by mass. So what we try to measure is galaxy assembly bias, right? A dependence of the galaxy clustering on something that correlates with the dark matter halo properties, like formation time. So that requires us to have a galaxy property that correlates with something like halo age, which is, it's not obvious that we will have one. So because of that tenuous connection, galaxy assembly bias is sort of more theoretically questionable. So to measure this, you would need to find two samples of galaxies that have the same underlying mass distribution, but they differ in some observable property that correlates with age. if they have the same galaxy bias that says bias just depends on mass, if they have different galaxy biases, you found assembly bias. Because their masses are the same, but their bias is different. And based on n-body simulations, we think that this should be the strongest at low mass. So this is a measure of galaxy bias for two samples split by their time of assembly. The red and blue curves are converging at high mass, meaning there's little assembly bias there. There's a lot at low mass. So in 2006, there was a claim detection of assembly bias based on a plot like the top one. It's the clustering for red and blue central galaxies for samples that are supposed to have the same halo mass. This is based on a group catalog where they have a proxy for halo mass, and they said, okay, these samples have the same halo mass, but look, their clustering differs. At the time, they didn't have a lensing, a catalog they could use to measure lensing, so I measured the lensing and found that actually the red galaxies live in more massive halos. So the clustering difference was because the samples are not the same mass. Fortunately, using lensing, we're able to identify samples with the same masses. And when we do this, we find the clusterings of those, the blue and red samples, are the same. So we only put upper limits on assembly bias, which leads to two possible interpretations. One, galaxy assembly bias doesn't exist. Or two, it exists, but we just didn't have a very good tracer of halo formation time, and we need a better one. So I'm going to skip through the next bit because it's going too long, but sorry. So basically, in the past year, what we've been seeing is that we expected to see assembly bias. It's a robust theoretical prediction for dark matter halos, but so far we failed to find it, which rules out already some models of galaxy formation that have very strong assembly bias. So either it's not there, or maybe we need a better tracer of halo properties. So to conclude, weak lensing can now be used with existing surveys and upcoming surveys to learn about the detailed relationship between galaxy optical properties and dark matter halos. We've used it in the past year or so to learn about bimodality and halo mass at fixed stellar mass. We've learned that galaxy quenching is predominantly controlled by something that correlates with halo mass. And we failed to find assembly bias, which is kind of interesting. And there are many prospects for further discovery in ongoing and upcoming data sets. Thank you.
So you mentioned looking at density, halo mass, clustering, and age, but you didn't mention abundance. So like abundance matches. So does this, if you just count the number of objects of a given mass, and does it tell you about the comparative theoretical halo mass function? Does it then tell you about sigma 8 feedback?
If you have some abundance of objects, say above stellar mass, and you have a mass function, you can do abundance matching, but it's very model dependent. And so depending on what you hold fixed and what you let be free, you can learn a lot of different things. But that model dependence is a tough nut to crack. So an example, so the age matching model I mentioned starts out with abundance matching. They just have an expected halo mass function and an observed stellar mass function, and they match them to each other in a almost one-to-one way. There's scatter, but then we saw that that's actually ruled out by the observations, and that color has to be folded into that connection. So you can learn a variety of things from abundance matching, but you have to be a little bit careful about what you're assuming in terms of how the halo and galaxy properties correlate.
As I understand it, sometimes really like galaxies have a steeper stellar mass function, like low masses, and more low mass stars. I'm not listening.
Wait, is the, sorry, about the IMF?
You're,
okay, yeah.
So the relatively more low mass stars change the, that would truly change the stellar mass in the Earth.
Yeah, so what that would do is, let me just go back here for a second, I'm sorry. Way back. So what that would do in general is the, right, if the stellar mass to light ratio, so in that scenario, the Red Galaxy stellar mass to light ratio has been underestimated. It should actually be higher, right? And so the curves would shift together, but they need to shift by a factor of 3 to match these up. And the models, if you consider like the models that are put forward for how much the IMF is modified, it's more like a 30%, not a factor of 3. So you're right, it does help in shifting the curves together, but it can't shift them that much as far as I know. I mean, generically, in hydrodynamic simulations, for example, the AGN feedback is one of the important determinants of the stellar mass function at high mass, right? The when they turn on AGN feedback at some reasonable level, the massive galaxies are, quench much earlier and don't form quite as much stellar mass. So that is generically why I said that was one possible model for halo quenching, right? The massive halos host the galaxies that have strong enough AGN that they could quench them. But as to whether it can explain the exact magnitude of this effect, my understanding is that it could, but a more interesting test would be to do this, if we had this kind of data at higher redshift, when the processes were supposed to have been kind of ongoing as opposed to finished a while ago.
So a sort of old-timey model, if only red galaxies were able to just drive points along the red line here and try to figure out if it's a one-to-one relation. So is that, where does it push them off?
So you're...
remarkably thin.
Well, this error envelope is the error on the mean. So the intrinsic scatter, we believe, is broader than that. So.
Okay, so but does it preserve?
So the slope of this curve is a bit steeper than 1, right? So it wouldn't exactly preserve it. I don't think it would exactly preserve it, but I mean, it's not terribly off either.
It looks like it made a good shape. People might have merged red and blue things. I'm just kind of concocting the simplistic evolution.
I would have to think about that a little bit more, but then. Merging red and blue things as a way to make more red things, but then how did you get the red thing that was first going to merge with the blue thing?
Well, everything started off blue. So and, I'm just imagining here,
yeah.
This diagram, where, what this like, is trying to relate to your higher redshift data. Points move with redshift.
Yeah, that's a good question. I'm not sure that a simple model for red-red merging is exactly going to do what you want, but that is one of the reasons why I was hoping that with HSC we'll be able to trace this relation across Redshift, because the merger model versus like an AGN feedback model, as far as I understand, don't have the same Redshift dependencies.
Yeah, I thought you found a radio profile. It's very similar to the
Redshift, right? The average radio profile of the halos. Well, I don't think so. I mean, if you have, say, a sample of halos selected in n-body simulations with a semi-analytic model, and you compare the lensing profiles for the red and blue, they look fairly similar in radial profile, but presumably like halos have been merging, right, in the simulation and things like that. So I don't think that the similarity of the profiles is very informative about the merging model. So in principle, yes. So our assertion is not that, you know, that just the halo quenching model on its own is the right answer. It's that a successful model needs to include halo quenching. It could also include other things like stellar mass quenching, but that on its own doesn't describe the data, and so it could be halo quenching with something else. So like in our view, this is not necessarily ruling out, you know, something like assembly bias or a small amount of stellar mass quenching or whatever. We just felt it was an interesting fact that you can describe the data very well with just a simple halo quenching and no fancy, you know, things on top of it.
So let's cover a speaker thing.